Hello everyone, welcome to Fraktio's Perjantai Race, and today our own Vitali is going to give us an audiovisual presentation about Dolomites of Italy.
Yes,
yes.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you very much. Yes, the Dolomites are actually in Italy. It's actually a certain type of rock that was, I think, I might be talking out of my ass here, but coined by some French geologist back in the day. I'm sure his last name was Dolomite. I don't know. But okay, yeah, so definitely, let's get on with the presentation. So this September, I traversed through the Dolomites. This is a really lovely picture taken by Mika-Pekka Markkanen, one of the three people on this trip aside from me. And so, you know, how did I end up in the middle of nowhere walking in the Italian mountains? Well, it all started, like many things today, with Reddit. It actually goes back to the early 2016, so 2 years before my Dolomite trip. And there was a thread that asked, what is the most beautiful place you've ever seen? And a lot of people said Lauterbrunnen, which is a place in Switzerland. So I was intrigued and I wanted to go see it. So I planned a really epic trip with my friend, a road trip to span 8 countries in 10 days. It was a bit crazy. and we did it, but we didn't go to Italy. One leg of it was gone. So the idea was to go see Lauterbrunnen in Switzerland by driving through Germany. And then going to the Czech Republic to see an old friend, go to a forest party, and go home. And, you know, we drove. I had never really done anything like this before, and it was really fun. Here's Samsa, who I did it with. And, you know, I got to see things I had never seen before. It was truly magnificent. You know, I had my drone, and I flew it around, and it was really beautiful. And through a lot of effort, I mean, driving through Sweden and Germany takes a while. But when I saw Lauterbrunnen, it was really worth it. I mean, it was majestic as hell. You know, it's the valley of waterfalls. You know, I think in this picture alone, there's like 3 or 4. And I mean, it's just like behind there on the right, there's actually a mountain. And inside the mountain, there's a waterfall. Like, I mean, the place is like straight La La Land. And I mean, I saw stuff that I had never seen before. You know, here's the sun rays behind a mountain in Austria, where we were close to where they have the Ötzi caveman and whatnot. And I got to see old friends and make new friends and got to see places I had never seen before. And we did a lot of driving, but we never got to Italy because it was really busy we had a really tight schedule and the weather was really bad when we were down south and we really needed to make it to Czech Republic to see our friends and get to the forest party. So we decided to skip it. And you know, I really got enchanted with the experiences that I had during this road trip. You know, we were camping out, you know, you'd wake up to these really majestic kind of sights and, you know, you'd got to really like kind of feel what it is like to be outdoors. But yeah, no Italy. And I really wanted to go. So I decided next year, I'm only going to Italy. I'm just going to go to Italy and check out the part that I didn't see. And so to Italy I went. And this is Tre Cime. And it was really fantastic. I mean, it was just as beautiful and just as amazing as I thought. I went with my then girlfriend, and I mean, it was beautiful. It was great. And you know, we went to other places. We checked out the Ligurian coast, and we had a lot of fun. But the mountains called for me. And we had rented a car, and we drove around, and I really felt like it was actually an impediment. Like that, to really enjoy and to really experience the mountains, I had to go and walk with my own 2 feet and really like kind of wing it, so to say. And so after these types of trips, you know, I did more camping outdoors in Finland. And, you know, Finland, even this is in Nuuksio. I mean, you know, there's a lot of beautiful nature here. It's not quite as mountainous as I would like, but, you know, you definitely get your money's worth, so to say. And so I got some equipment, you know, I really started learning more about being outdoors. I did an extreme kind of adventure to Norway, where my friend Mikso, who was with me in Italy and who took the picture in the beginning of this presentation, So he's like a wilderness guide by profession. And so we went and, you know, we checked out Senja, which is a mountain up in northern Norway. And it was really beautiful, really majestic. I had never really seen anything quite like it. And I mean, I definitely had enough of the cold after that. I was like, okay, let's go somewhere a bit warmer. And so I'm not sure how exactly I first heard of Alta Via 1, which is the route that I took, but I knew that once I heard about it, it kind of stuck. You know, it sounded challenging enough and interesting enough that it was worth trying, you know, but it sounded kind of intense. You know, it's a pretty long route stretching from the beginning of the journey, which is from Lago di Braias, the Braias River, and it goes all the way down close to Belluno. And, you know, it's 120 kilometers. It's about 5 kilometers up, 7 kilometers down throughout. And, you know, it's challenging. But still, it didn't sound impossible. You know, I looked at people writing about it in their blogs and whatnot, and, you know, it seemed more than doable. And so the history of Alta Via 1 is that it's called the Road of Peace. And at the end of World War I, which ended 100 years ago exactly, it was the road that Italian soldiers traversed to go back home after the war. And I mean, it really seemed like something I wanted to do. And so I found this book published by Cicerone, written by a really cool dude, Gillian Price. And I mean, you know, I thought that this was the beginning, but this is actually the whole thing. We were supposed to buy, there's this manufacturer of maps called Tabacco, and they make like the best maps. And we thought like, okay, once we get to Italy, we get to the area, we'll buy some Tabacco maps. And you know, this will be like a fun kind of book to tell us stories about what we're walking through. But no, this is the only book that we use through the whole trip. I can't recommend it enough if you're doing this trip. It tells you all the turns and what to look out for. And it really was the backbone of this trip. And so what this book does is that it breaks down the hike into 11 stages of varying difficulty and of length, and kind of, you know, it makes it palatable. It gives you the template of how to do it. The only difference being is that this book kind of assumes that you begin and end your journey at mountain huts. So there's these things called refugios, which are on mountains where you can rest for a fee. But usually you're looking at 30 to 60 euros a night. And, you know, it wasn't the experience we were going for. So instead of walking with very light gear and spending our nights in a nice room, we carried 20 plus kilos and had everything on us. And, you know, we did drop by at the refugios and we ate there, but we never stayed in one. Except there was a few nights, there's also these things called... Damn, now I'm having a blackout. But basically these like emergency shelters, and you can basically stay there for free if they're not occupied. They're called bivacos actually, yeah. And so a few nights we stayed in bivacos, yeah, I'll talk about that a bit in a bit. But in general, this book was really important. We studied it a lot. We started looking at the route through Google Earth, and we started training. So we, you know, pack our bags and, you know, walk up mountains and walk long routes. There was three of us and we didn't have a three-person tent. So we bought a tent specifically for this trip. We went and we tested it and we really thought about what we would take. You know, so for me, especially because I like to do photography, you know, over here we got some gear and that amounts to 5 kilograms in total of extra weight on top of everything else. You know, and this was after I tried to cut it down as little as possible. So I wasn't really doing myself any favors here. But I really tried my best to select light lenses and to really like cut it down to as little as possible. And thankfully Pekis allowed me to borrow his drone, which was a really nice help for the trip to get some nice shots. But just a quick rundown. So basically some clothes, some shoes or flip-flops to use when we're not trekking. We got an air mattress, we have a good sleeping bag, night clothes, layers, oven, eating supplies, technology bag with all kinds of chargers, adapters, etc., etc., hygiene bag, first aid kit, water filter, which is really awesome. So we could filter water from any source and use it as long as it wasn't salt water, which of course in the middle of the mountains, no problem. A little air pillow and straps for random strap usage, walking sticks, extra pants, tube scarf, and the Fjällräven Kajka 85 liter backpack, which in my opinion is the best pack of all time. Jani?
Did you have solar panels?
Well, I would have wanted to have solar panels. My 8,000 milliamp hour battery had a solar power or solar panel on it, but it was very small and ultimately it didn't really help much. I never really got a proper charge out of it, so I would have needed to actually like order a proper fold-out solar panel. I was thinking originally of buying one, but then I really couldn't justify the weight increase. So ultimately, I opted to kind of just carry basic stuff, and I actually kind of screwed up. My only regret is that I took the charger of the drone, which has two USB inputs, and I thought that, well, okay, this is awesome. I can charge the drone and two USB devices, but actually, as it turns out, it is really bad in distributing power, so I would actually end up charging devices for some time and then realizing they got no charge, which was quite frustrating, but ultimately not essential. So everything that I needed to survive was analog, so it wasn't that bad. And ultimately, there wasn't too much time to even take photographs. Like, it was pretty much just a lot of walking. And I ultimately did not take anything extra. Everything I took with me, I used, and I was really proud that I managed to, with this equipment, take care of everything. So the only thing not pictured here is the tent, which we took turns dividing among ourselves. We had the fabric and we had the poles. And of course, in addition to all of this, we also had food supplies. So pretty much, you know, this is the pack that I went with, a little over 20 kilos or around 20 kilos and then plus food. So around 23 in total. And so then it was time to go. And I actually did a little detour. I went to Barcelona where I lived for a year and spent a few days seeing old friends. And then I hooked up with the guys in Milan. So this was my troop, me, Mikso, and Olli. And we met up in Milan. We stuck out like sore thumbs. Not many tourists there walking around with full gear. And then we used Italy's great train system to go about. And we didn't go straight for Alta Via 1 because Mikso, being the wilderness expert and thorough researcher that he is, discovered something really amazing that we just had to go see, which was not very far from where we would begin our trip. And that was the Pyramides over in close to Bolzano. And so these are naturally forming pyramid poles, which happen geologically because there are rocks under sediment, and then throughout a long, long period of time, rain comes and takes away with erosion all the land around it, leaving nothing but the pole underneath. And you can see that there are some that are a bit sharper where the rock has tumbled off, but it's really cool sight to see when you're staring at these natural pyramids. And we actually got permission. We got through to a person's farm, which is really steep, and we got pretty close up to see them in person, and they were really majestic. And so after this, we started the trip. We went to stage zero, which was Lake Braies, Lago di Braies, which is probably one of the most Instagrammed places on planet Earth, and for good reason. I mean, the place is gorgeous. Pictures really do not do it justice. From there we started our trip, and it was really like day one was, you know, forget about it. It was like, you know, 400 meters of straight vertical ascent for, I don't remember how many kilometers, I have the chart at the end, but it was pretty damn tough to go from 1.5 kilometers to, I think, or was it like 1.6 kilometers to about 2 kilometers. And yeah, I mean, you know, it's just left foot, right foot, ultimately. And, you know, you take a bunch of breaks, and you see the lake disappear before your eyes. And then it started to get really magical, it started to get really cool. And that was basically the really nice balance in this trip, is that, like, it got tough, but it was also really beautiful. So you could really lose yourself into the scenery. And I brought some, like, audiobooks with me. I had a wireless headphones. I didn't really use them because it's like you just want to be in the moment, you just want to be present. And so yeah, when we got over the hump, we got to the pass, we saw Rifugio Biella, which was the first Rifugio on the route, on the footsteps of Monte Becco. And we made our first stop for food. And I tell you that after you walk the whole day, nothing tastes more refreshing than the meal you get. Even if it's just a basic polenta and a jug of beer, it is delicious. So that definitely makes it all worth it. And we set up tent, or set up camp, and slept well. And then the next day we decided, like, hey, we're next to this big ass mountain. We're in the beginning of our trip. Why don't we go up it and, you know, conquer it? And so we ate like the smallest breakfast you could imagine, 2 packets of instant porridge split among 3 people. We took some water with us. Everyone forgot to bring snacks, and up we went. And we realized this was a tactical error, that going up to the top of a mountain, no matter how close it is not a walk in the park morning activity. You should prepare better. So this was definitely something that we kind of messed up on. But it was not bad. It was actually quite beautiful. It was really foggy, as you can see, but it started to clear up, and it was really beautiful. And we actually saw some chamois, or as I insisted that we pronounce it for our dear performer of Michael Jackson, we should call them Shemmo. So yeah, they were really beautiful. And there was even some Alp chows, which are really interesting birds. They're super curious, and they come around, and they were really frustrated that the plastic wrapping that they heard was not like snacks. And we just tried to tell them that, yes, we are frustrated too. We are very hungry. And here I flew the drone for the first time, and it was, you know, like the fog came and went. So it was, we couldn't see the lake below, but it still was pretty damn epic, because we suddenly realized this light phenomenon. The pictures really don't do it justice, but it's called glory, and it's very specific weather conditions. You'll see this halo effect that envelops you, and I mean, it felt like we were being blessed. It's hard to put into words. It was really beautiful. And so, you know, as the fogs would wisp away, the scenery just looked amazing. And it was time for us to continue. So this is Becco in all its glory. Its peak is actually kind of behind there. And here you can see Biella, and we had our tent somewhere around here. I got some video material I'll show a bit later, but for now we're just gonna go through this slideshow and get through this thing. So that was basically day one and day two. Day two, we head out to continue. And I mean, you know, it was just really epic and really sweet. You know, we got some alpine bovines. We got a lot of religious imagery, because Italy. And, you know, so I don't even know what this is, like how to explain. There's so many things you see on this trip where you're just like, I do not have the words. But it was really beautiful. And of course, you know, there's still the practicalities of the day-to-day. You don't pack your whole wardrobe, so, you know, you got to do some laundry, and you start looking like, you know, a kind of like a, what you call, like a witch, you know, some, it kind of, it has this Finnish element to it. I can't really explain it, but it felt kind of like we were bringing some Finnish vibes over to that Italian landscape. And, you know, we'd walk, and I mean, it was just magnificent. It was majestic. It was every positive adjective you could throw at it. I mean, and what really was beautiful was when we got to Lagazui. And so Lagazui is a mountain area consisting of 2 mountains and a valley. We're now here on Lagazui Grande, which is what you walk up to. And below you have the Lagazui Lake. And I mean, really, like, around the surrounding area is all rock. It's all very barren. And then in the middle of this, you see this like hobbit-like kind of oasis of green and beauty. And I mean, it was really majestic. And during World War I, this is where they had the most casualties. And it wasn't like they were shooting at people. No, they were clandestinely drilling and putting TNT and then exploding and hoping that they wipe out more enemy than themselves. I mean, it was really brutal stuff, especially in the middle of winter. I mean, it was probably unspeakable. But the place was really beautiful. You know, we went down, and this is kind of like what the trip was. You know, you'd go up and you'd be like, and then you'd be like, wow, and then you go down, you know, and going down was always a bit more tricky because you're packing a lot of weight, and the kind of area that you have to walk is not luxurious and nor well supported. There was a lot of places where there was landslides, so we'd be walking on big wobbly rocks. But you know, thankfully we had walking poles. Without them, I'm sure the trip wouldn't have been nearly as fun nor necessarily as successful. And you know, when I'd find the energy, I'd do a little bit of night photography, but usually by the end of the day, you're just like exhausted. But when you're treated with scenes like this, you just want to stay up and make the most of the day, or I mean the night. And so once we got to Lago Azul Piccolo, it was undescribable. I mean, it was the most beautiful panoramic view I have ever seen in my life. I think it's at 2.6 kilometers, and every direction that you look, it's just magnificent. And they even have a sauna up there. And no, we did not go because we didn't want to wait around for it and pay like, I don't know, I don't remember the price, but it was pretty big. It was pretty big. And yeah, I mean, it was just amazing. Every direction you would look, you would just see the most beautiful things. And what we did, because, you know, we came to do, not to watch, we went down and we took our backpacks into a garage of a business that was down there, and we went back up, and then we hiked down through the World War I Open Air Museum, which is a bunch of tunnels, wet, dark tunnels, which actually opened up to some really, really beautiful vistas, especially during the sunset. And I actually, this was the only time I injured myself. I slipped and bruised my rib a little bit, but actually got away pretty scot-free, and I'm really grateful that I didn't have my camera with me because it probably would have shattered. And so after this, we had kind of come to a junction. So we had been trekking for almost a week and we were kind of running low on supplies. So we had to make a strategic decision. And this is where I have to make a confession. We did not complete stage four, I think it was, of the trip. Instead, we hitchhiked to Cortina d'Ampezzo and back so that we could resupply. And it was like the most Swiss Italian village you could imagine, the prices including. And we stayed in some suburban area next to some, squeezed between two like really nice looking mansions in this field. And we were woken up to this guy and his friends. It was quite fun. And then we went back, we got a ride from this German couple, and we went to Passo Giao, which was a really beautiful place. And we were really aching. Like, it was kind of hard for three dudes with enormous backpacks to get a ride. Shout out to Paul for giving us a ride to Cortina d'Ampezzo and that old German couple for getting us back. But anyway, we headed through Passo Giao, and we were really ecstatic to be back on the trail. And, you know, I mean, there are so many things that I'm like leaving out because of time. Like, you know, we'd go to a refugio, and then there's like this table full of people dressed up in like folk clothing, and they're playing like folk tunes from around the world, you know? And it's just like, what? Like, you just walk into these situations where you're just like, whatever, just roll with it. And it was really amazing. Like, you know, you would never know what you would find. And, you know, we spent a lot of time outdoors, and it was actually kind of weird. We were laughing about it because it seemed like the more south we'd go, the colder the nights got, which just didn't make sense. But it was definitely worth it, you know, getting up in the morning and then just seeing layers of mountains as far as the eye could see was indescribable. I mean, you just find this serenity and this calmness and this beauty there. And one thing that happened was that because we started this trip in the middle of September, and that's really at the tail end of the season. So a lot of refugios were going closed. And this is one example, this Città di Fiume. We thought that this would be closed because the book said that it would be, but they kind of, you know, decide on when the season ends as the season progresses. And this was actually their last day of operation. So, you know, when you're walking and you've had a really cold morning and you've been, you know, you're just kind of exhausted, and then suddenly you see this place that serves, you know, bacon and eggs and beer, you're just like, woo, I won the lottery. I mean, it's really an amazing feeling. And so here is the Rifugio Staulanza, which represents the point of no return. So as I said, Alta Via 1 consists of 11 stages, and at stage 6 is the last bus stop before the end. So this is really where you make or break. You know, you have to really decide, like, of course there's, you know, helicopter evacuation points and all this kind of stuff, but basically if you decide after stage 6 that, you know, mommy, I want to go home, or like, I've had enough, you know, whatever, it's going to be a really tough time for you. So, but we were feeling really great. We were like, you know, no problem. We're having a great time. So we went forward. And so when you know that you're on the right path when you see this sign, because they actually mark the Alta Via 1 route with this big blue triangle. And it was always a nice thing to see, especially when you're a bit like, you know, are we on the right path? Were we supposed to make a left there? And then you see this good dude and you're just like, yeah, we're on the right path. And so this is us having a night at Koldai. And Kold is really, it was a premonition, because we, you know, we thought like, man, this place is cool, like, you know, no wind, it's really nice. And then we wake up and then the ground is like this, you know. And that's the really crazy how the temperature would fluctuate, because I had this little compass that had a thermometer on it. And like it would sometimes overreact. It would go over its limit. It would go to 50 Celsius, and if it'd be directly in the sun, it would say it's more than 50, which is of course ludicrous. But and then in the mornings, it could show -4, and you know, we'd find places with permafrost, and it was really like you had to be ready for all possible weather conditions. We were really lucky. Mostly, we had sunshine and good vibes. We had a few days of like trickle rain. But usually at the end of that, we were rewarded with some really nice, for example, this folk song, Rifugio session, or other things like that. Once we, if we ever had to pay the price of kind of suffering a little bit. And the most kind of epic day that we had was a day where we trekked in total for 11 hours. So, you know, we did like stage 2 and we did stage 3 in two parts, because we kind of took it easy and we were finding our bearings and all that, and we kind of gave ourselves more time that we didn't have to like kind of go at a crazy pace. But on this day, we kind of had to continue. So Mont Civetta is one of the biggest mountains on Alta Via 1. I think its highest point, if I don't forget, is like 3.2 kilometers, and it's a really big mother of a mountain. And so we began the day at the northernmost tip of Civetta, and we walked on its, so from your perspective here, so on its west side, and we ended the day on its southernmost tip. And the reason why we continued so late, even after the sunset, was because there was literally no place to pitch a tent. It was like so steep that we just couldn't stop, and so we continued until we found a flat enough place to put up a tent, and it actually turned out to be really awesome. I don't know how I had the energy, but I actually stayed up and took some night photos, because there was like this ancient kind of stone buildings there. I'm not sure if it was actually World War I or before, but they looked like they had been built with really old school techniques. So I think actually even the book talks about it being like an ancient barracks, but the whole place had this like really interesting vibe to it. So I wanted to stick around and take some dope photos of it. But yeah, so, you know, that's how it was. Left foot, right foot. And you'd be rewarded with ever-changing sceneries. You'd get everything from, you know, kind of like Scottish type of like valleys to epic Swiss type mountains and, you know, everything in between. It was really breathtaking throughout. And it was great that we had that water filter, so we very rarely had to worry about water, because there was all kinds of places where water would concentrate and be running. Even if it was a small trickle of a stream, we would be able to use our water filter to get some water. And so when we got to Moseshin, we found this old kind of dilapidated farmhouse that had been turned into a bivacco, so one of those places where you could stay. And I mean, it was really rudimentary. I mean, it really felt like you were traveling back in time when you stayed at that place. Let's just say that the fireplace had not been cleaned in a while, so we really got smoked. Everything from that point onward had that special Moshishin smell to it. And we actually found some jelly packs, and so we made ourselves some old stale bread that we had taken from some other place and put some jam on it and had ourselves a nice merry breakfast. And as we walked, this was, I think, in Pramper, there was some old barracks which were used during the First World War. And we kept walking, and then we got to Malga Pramper, which is a farmhouse that kind of is open to the public and is all about showing like the latest agricultural techniques and whatnot. And they had actually closed, but we met a really cool dude who was running the place. And he said, like, you know, don't worry, sit down. He gave us the last beers he had and the last meat and bread. And I mean, it was great. He even sold us some wine. It was more than we could have hoped for. And then we kept going, and we came to, what was the name of that area? I see that I've had a long week. Let's see.
It was the Rifugio Pramper, right.
So when we were heading, I saw these tadpole-infested river. It was pretty cool to see those little dudes swimming about. You know, that's going to become a frog. I had never seen anything like that in my adult life. And, you know, this is like when going was good, this is the kind of snacks we would have. You know, we had some cured meat and some really nice cheese and the wine and some herbs. I mean, they even had their own beer. There was this really cool moment where we got to a rifugio on the same day when we were at Città di Fiume, and then that place was closing. We got to actually that rifugio Coldai, which was close to that place where you saw that nighttime photo from. And so they were closing, and so I said to them with my horrible Google Translate skills of like, hey, if you guys have something that you guys are like throwing away, like we're pretty low on supply, so like if you want to get rid of them, you can just like give it to me and we can eat it. And they're like, no, we have this deal with the nature around us that we leave it outside and then the animals come and eat it. And we were like, okay. And so we sit down, and then some dude, I guess, who overheard it was a bit like, man, these guys deserve something. And then he gave us all another round of beers for free, and we just felt like we won the lottery. You know, this is like awesome. And it's really, really tasty. If you're ever in Italy, try birra Dolomiti. And usually our food after we ran out of, we had these dry packed foods called turmat, the best. Quite expensive, but way worth it. After that, we had to use knorr and our own cooking skills and with very, very limited capabilities. Like, I generally say I cook pretty well, but it was really challenging to make super tasty food with just one pot and the ingredients we had. But it was all worth it, because again, super beautiful, and the night times were really amazing. And even through the nighttime, even when you wake up, you know, I mean, astrologically, it was really cool. We got to see the International Space Station fly above us a few times. We had, I think it was Mars, Jupiter, and Venus at the same time. And there was another planet, I don't remember, but it was below the horizon. Like, astrologically, it was just a really beautiful time. There was a full moon and all this stuff, which, of course, made it difficult to get the Milky Way, but it was a price we gladly paid. And toward the end of the trip, this was from the last kind of peak place. Everything from here was literally downhill. And so we kind of made the most of it. And this is like a photo that I think really encapsulates the trip, because we're up high above and we really didn't know if we could manage to pull it off. I mean, even though my friend is a wilderness guide and he's, you know, done a crazy amount of exploring and traveling, guy's been published in National Geographic. I mean, the guy has photos. He had never done anything like this before, and none of us had ever committed to doing something for 2 weeks straight. It was only during the trip where I really realized like that this is something really exceptional that we've been doing, so I had to, of course, cap it off. But it was a time for reflection. You know, it was really a time to kind of think about, you know, what this means. And here's me pondering a bit more. But I mean, the thing is that you're just doing it. You don't have time. You don't really think about what it is that you're doing. And suddenly, you know, it's gone. So, you know, it's something that's good to try to bring to everyday life, to really just do your best to be in the moment and to
not be so concerned about what was or what will be, but just really be there and experience it for what it is. And so, you know, we started to say goodbye to the mountains, and, you know, we'd see more signs of peril, but we just, you know, went through the forests, went down, and before we knew it, we were at the bus stop waiting to go to Belluno. And from here, we went to Garda, and then Milan, and we partied, and we had fun, and we just couldn't believe our luck of how blessed we are to have done such a nice thing. And so, just some statistics to round it off. In the end, so I had an Apple Watch in my phone. Mixo had just his phone, which was a bit less accurate, but the problem was is that like my phone would sometimes die and my watch would die and I wouldn't have any information, but we actually used the numbers to average, and I apparently walk a little slower than everyone else. And so we used that to kind of estimate my steps, and it kind of rounded off nicely. And so I took almost 400,000 steps, Mixo took around 330, and in total we walked plus minus 300 kilometers during this 2 weeks, which was pretty crazy to look at it in the end, because it felt like we were walking a lot, but it didn't feel like we were walking 300 kilometers. I mean, we thought it'd be 120, but of course, you know, it's actually called the infinite border paradox. So if you take any route, so in this case, let's talk about like land or like border areas. So like the US has 5 official border radiuses. And the reason for it is that if you have, well, let's say like this irregular shaped irregular shaped object, and then we use something like this remote to measure its border, we get one value that's kind of small. But then if we use something which is much smaller as a measuring stick, we get a much more accurate border around it, which of course then has more surface area. So this is why every complicated border has basically an infinite border radius, because it all depends on what measuring stick you're using, on what end result you're going to get. And so I kind of thought about for this to like, what can I give as tips for you guys if you're ever going to do something like this. First thing, you know, water filter, if you're out and about, is really awesome. I mean, in Finland, you basically don't need it. But the thing is that if you got like a dead animal in the water that you're drinking from, you can get really sick. And this water filter that I bought is called the Life Straw. Yeah, the Life Straw Mission. So they have a literal straw version, which is like 20 bucks, and then this is a bit over 100 bucks, which has a 5-liter container, and it just works. I mean, it takes care of all the viruses, all the bacteria. You just get nothing but pure water. You can literally take sewage and drink it, and it'll be fine.
It's magic.
It's magic. You know, nanoparticles, quantum, blah blah. You know, it just works.
It's it. How about battery?
No. It just uses gravity. Or with the straw, it uses your sucking to power it, and with this, it uses gravity to pull water down. It goes through some filters, and you get clean water. So really handy. And another thing was this North Face thermal ball jacket. You know, I did my Norway trip with it. It's really compact, it's really thin, it's a technical down, and it packs up into its own pocket, so that was really helpful. And of course, you know, have a lot of layers, have a second set of gloves, all those things help. And then also walking sticks, like really do not go trekking without walking sticks. XXL has for like 30 bucks the ones that I used, which I think are better than like the 200 euro ones, because they're super light. They have shock absorbers. I mean, they held my weight perfectly. There's nothing that I can say bad about them, and they're perfect and they're cheap, so use them. And another thing, as a photographer, Peak Design's capture clip allowed me to have my camera easily available at all times with just one button. I got it and then I put it away. So if you have a strap, it's gonna really cause sores on your neck. If you use other, I mean, if you got something that works for you, great. But for me, this Peak Design capture was the best. And the Fjällräven Kajka was the best backpack. It's a pretty heavy backpack. It's like 4 kilos just on its own, but it has Finnish birch wood supports on the back, which really distributes the weight nicely. So if you're going with a bit more gear, it's the best backpack that I know of. It's really smart. And 5 tips. First off, you know, don't rush. Walk at your own pace. If you feel like you're pushing your limits, you know, back it off, because it's a marathon, not a sprint. Second, be prepared. You know, really take the time to know what you're getting into, make sure that you got the gear, and walk around with the gear for a few days before you go and do this epic journey. So scale it up. Another thing, keep your feet dry. So we didn't even get a single blister. Like, we really managed. The only thing I got was when I slipped in that cave and I bruised my rib. Every time you stop, just take off your shoes, get them aerated, let that moisture go. And then at the end of the day, you know, stretch in the mornings, do a little warm up before you head out, and drink a lot of water and eat a lot of food, because it's a lot of energy to exert. So yeah, that's pretty much it for the pictures. I got a few more videos, but thank you. And if there's no questions, let's just quickly go to, okay, Jani?
Yeah, the cave you went to, and I saw there was one picture of the opening when you came out of, I guess. Do you know if, I've seen some photos from out there that include like this cave opening and the view behind. Do you know if that one is like the place where people take their Instagram pictures that have that kind of frame?
Yeah, well, I mean, I've seen some of those images also from like Trecime, which is one of the areas that I visited in 2017. So I would say that, I mean, this is an open air museum. So it's a very unique place where they have these caves and tunnels that were built during World War I by soldiers. But these mountains have a lot of natural caves as well. So it's hard to say, like, I'm sure it's a very popular one, but I've seen a lot of kind of these cave type shots from around the Dolomites, which have been also from other areas.
Any climbing out there?
Yes. There's Via Ferrata routes as well. And we were really bummed that we didn't really find the time to do it. Like, there was a lot of stuff we would have wanted to do, like next to Cortina di Ampezzo, there was this, they say a lake even more beautiful than Lago di Braies. I don't remember its name right now, but we didn't manage to go there because the bus connections had stopped. So that's also the reason why we had to hitchhike, because the day that we arrived to Italy was the day that the last buses for the whole year ran. So it really depends on the the time of year when you're going. So. Okay, so a little bit of drone footage first. This is back from the beginning of the trip, Mount Becco, or Mount Il Becco, actually. And so here you see Rifugio Biella, and our tent is somewhere around there. And I mean, you know, it really looks like, you know, you're on Mars or in the moon or something. It's really something different. Actually, I was wrong. Yeah, shit. Our tent is... should be able to see it, but it's around here somewhere, actually. Yeah, there it is, actually. You can see it. Yeah. That's the tent right there. Okay. Okay, yeah, then more drone footage. This is from closer. This is actually from the very end of the trip. So here I'm going to try to do some Michael Bay type of sweeps. Here we go. I went a little fast with it. Oop. And we actually got lucky. There was these people who lived around the area who came up, and we chatted with them and got some of their advice and ideas of what. And I mean, the guys who we met, he said that he just lived around the world. He's traveled all the places, and in his opinion, the Dolomites are the most beautiful place on earth. And we really couldn't disagree with him there. Yeah, here's some mountain chows. Flying around. I mean, there was a lot of them at times. And then here's a good kind of perspective on how it was to walk. So, you know, you had to really watch your step. And this is not the most extreme. So there was like grades 1 to 3 that we basically went through. And, you know, this is grade 1. This is as easy as it gets. And then sometimes, like, it would be really steep and very narrow. So, you know, you'd make a wrong if you would make a wrong step, it could be life-threatening. So you really had to kind of be alert, browsing Facebook while you're doing this stuff, which was fine also because it's not like you had very good reception around there. And anyway, I mean, you know, what's liking someone's post to looking at this? And here's also from, so this is back from the top of Rifugio Lagazui, looking around. And I mean, you know, because you just see for such a big distance, you really get these like God ray effects because the clouds are obstructing the sun in different places, and you know, it would just look amazing. And this is from the open air museum area. So this is us walking. And as you can see, this would have been pretty, not impossible, but really uncomfortable to do with our big backpack. So this was definitely a lot of fun. And that's also a really fun thing that in the Fjallraven Kajka, you can unstrap the topmost part and make it into a small backpack for when you're walking. And here we have some remnants of World War I. And then here there should come a small dolly around. So yeah, it was really majestic. Is that it? Yeah. So yeah, that's the trip. Thank you very much. Any questions? Okay.
What was your average trekking speed?
Ooh, that's a good one. I don't know. I really don't know, because I wasn't like kind of pushing like, okay, now I walk, now I stop. But our average was, actually, let's look, because we have the numbers here. So the general distance that we walked every day was a little under 20 kilometers. And it also kind of, I mean, of course, these numbers depend on also how much additional photography we did during the walking and after the walking. But that's really tough, because it also, it's hard to say, because there was a few days of traversing, so of walking kind of flatly and going around, but there was a lot of going up and going down. And even there, you can't say which is faster, because it depends on the technical skill and difficulty of the journey. So yeah, I mean, it varied a lot, but it averaged to around 20 kilometers a day. All right, so yeah, I mean, final words, I really recommend going out into nature, even if you're not going to the mountains, you know, even just something local like in Nuuksio or Porkkalaniemi or something like this. But if you're going, you know, you don't have to, you know, and I don't recommend going straight for like, you know, 2 weeks from zero, you know, just next time when you're abroad somewhere and visiting a city, you know, maybe take a few days to hike a mountain and, you know, pitch a tent. You can get a really cheap two-person tent for like 20, 30 bucks from Decathlon or, you know, these kind of local sports shops. And then you can give it to charity or some random homeless dude you see, you know, like there's all kinds of things that you could do to kind of like, you know, do it cheaper than just staying at a hotel and really make something that's meaningful and unique to you. Because, you know, like a lot of areas that we walked over there are places that used to be like ancient hunting grounds for, you know, prehistoric man. And when you're in this environment where you just feel this rich history, you get a totally different connection. And also a really nice thing is that when you're out tenting for a few weeks, like you sleep like a rock and your natural rhythms really get back into balance. So it's healthy, it's fun. After I came back, I went to a masseuse to make sure my, you know, everything's all right. And he was like, yeah, like your muscles are in the cleanest shape they've been when you've seen or come to my appointment. So I walked myself into better shape than what I was beforehand. So it's not destructive, it's constructive, as long as you do it with, you know, positivity and not trying to actually wreck yourself. You know, you don't have to pretend you're a Marine. yeah, so thanks a lot again for listening to my trip. And again, I hope this inspires you to go out there and see some nature for yourself.